Greetings everyone in Yeshua. Again, it's Boaz Newhoff here and Rob Moore from InThatDay.net, and we are sitting having a Shabbat discussion. We're glad that you can join with us. Probably going to hear a lot of rain because we've got a heavy rainstorm falling around us. So what we want to do today, we're continuing our discussion on the way of Yeshua versus the other ways, or the ways particularly what we're concerned of is the way that the Hebraic Roots movement is manifesting itself in these days, when many are becoming very close or converting to Judaism, and other shepherds and pastors in the or rabbis or whatever they call themselves in the Hebraic Roots movement have been calling for things like submitting to the future Sanhedrin of Judaism, which is coming, or honoring the coming temple that's going to be built by rabbinical Judaism, and so on. So what we are talking about here is, and I'm trying to, it's very difficult to, and I hope that you're understanding this, I'm not pointing to the Hebraic roots of the faith. The Hebraic roots of the faith, there's much to learn as we get continuity from Genesis through to Revelation, and that's a very important study. But the expression that has come to be known predominantly out of the heart of America, being the Hebraic Roots movement, is something that seems to be and has increasingly presented itself as something quite different and is influenced by specific religious worldviews. So my essential point that I'm making which we've been discussing over the past few Sabbaths, if you've been following us, the Hebraic Roots movement is essentially an overreaction to a polemical era, a religious polemical era. And that religious polemic is the polemic between Christendom, essentially historical Christendom, which is really the power of Rome, and rabbinicalism. So I'm using an analogy of a, to understand this, as a magnet. If you take a magnet, which is like a little bar of metal, on the one side you have one pole which attracts things to it, on the other side you have the opposite pole which attracts things to it. So the North Pole, the South Pole is sitting here, and if we could put Christendom on the one pole, that's what we mean by polemic. We're talking about religious polemics. Then it has such a powerful worldview that it will pull everything to it which it can attract. And if you're on the other pole, it has a religious worldview, which is rabbinical Judaism, and it pulls everything to itself that is attracted to it. And these are pulling in different directions. Now, what happens is that along the continuum of this metal bar, going from the North Pole to the South Pole, there's different positions where you'll find the power of each side begins to lose its power in favor of the other side. So, for example, we find Christian Zionism, which can be put along this pole, somewhere not close to the North Pole where Christendom, Roman Christendom would be, because they're evangelical, but they have a particular view of Israel, of Judah being in the state of Israel, and they have this theology of Christian Zionism, which I used to be many, many years ago, through ignorance, but realize now is actually not biblical at all. Then we find, where can we put the Hebraic Roots movement? Well, you go over the center line and you're moving now towards the rabbinical side of things, and you'll find the Hebraic Roots movement, because, and I'm talking about the movement, not the actual study of the Hebraic roots of the faith, but the movement, the religious movement, is now on the side of the polemical conflict and near rabbinicalism because of its rabbinical worldview. So this is what's happening. Because let me give evidence of what I'm saying. We always hear, and I've always heard conservative evangelicals talking about the heritage of Western society is its Judeo-Christian base. You see, there's the polemic. There's the North Pole, the South Pole. It's openly spoken about by theologians. It's our Judeo-Christian heritage. There's the polemic. So on the one side, it's seen, and they argue that this is Judaism, rabbinical Judaism, its ethics and so on, which of course we've learnt by studying the Hebraic Roots movement, that there's a big difference between the oral law of Judaism and the written law of Moses. Very big difference. So that's confusion in itself. But this is what predisposes the worldview of everything we can say that people today who consider themselves Christian or Messianic and so on is actually seeing the world through. This is the glasses that they wear. This colors their their perspective on things. And so this then influences all sorts of theologies that come out, systematic theologies, based on how strong the pull is to, let's say, historical Christendom here, where Rome says, no, they've replaced Israel, right? To the rabbinical side, and all grades or shades of grey that you want in between on this polemic, so that you have all these different theologies on what we can call Israelology, because this is the central thing. This polemic between the two is a battle over who controls the kingdom. And we, if we're looking at that in terms of biblical definition, we're actually looking at a study called Israelology. It's a theological study called Israelology. So depending on where you are sitting on this polemic of Christianity versus rabbinicalism, you're going to sit in a different place along this magnet based on your Israelology, you see. So if you see the church as spiritual Israel, for example, and then you see the Jewish people as physical Israel, for example, which is like the classical position of Arnold Fuchsenbaum, for example, then you're going to sit somewhere along this perspective here of this polemic, somewhere along here, and you have all sorts of other doctrines that will come from that, because you've got to resolve the difference now between spiritual Israel and physical Israel. And the way Arnold Fruchtenbaum does that is by developing the ground of dispensational theology. So, you know, things of one era, not in the next era, and so on, and different people are involved, because Arnold Fruchtenbaum is trying to overcome replacement theology, but in a way that can still explain the dispensations of who is Israel. Is it the church, or is it rabbinical Judaism? You see, so this is the tension that we're in, and these have dire consequences for our immediate future, because our immediate future, and we'll come to this as we close our discussion here, is that right now there's an ecumenicalism building between Rome and rabbinicalism for what's happening on the Temple Mount. And you know, there's some in the Hebraic Roots movement who's been saying, "Oh, well, when the rabbinics put their temple up, you know, this is something that is this is something that's been done by Yahweh. You put up the altar, and when they reestablish the sacrifice, you mustn't speak against it, and all these things." Well, is that actually correct? Is it biblically correct? Is this the way of Yeshua? This is the question. But what you're going to find is that coming up in the future is that the Pope is going to be condoning this and be in together with it, you see, because I was alerted this last week how on the latest papal visit, the Pope went from Bethlehem to Jerusalem. So he spoke with the politicians in Bethlehem, he spoke with the politicians in Jerusalem, where he went to and he caused controversy with this wall of division protecting the state of Israel. And then he went over to the king of Jordan, and on the way he went to this place, I might have the name wrong, called Mepizo Jericho, which is just a little settlement outside of Jericho, which began the construction of a template, of a replica of the temple with the altar, so that they could be, because they've established the high priest garments, and it's all the altar they've built. I saw that actually, the video on YouTube, when they laid the foundations for it. They've been practicing the sacrifices, so everything's been put in place so that this building can be constructed really quickly, and everything can operate very quickly. They're already training the priests and so on and so forth. Now remember, last week we discussed biblical authority, and we discussed the issue of, you know, this claim to priests, where the rabbinics have actually no biblical claim whatsoever to priests. This is all constructionism based on their theology. Mm-hmm. So these things are happening right now, and I was quite amazed to see how fast they are happening since the year 2010.
Yeah, I think what everybody has to realize, and what everybody needs to do, because what we're going to talk about today is going to come as a big surprise to some people, is to read the United Nations Resolution 181, which is setting up a United Nations of Religions with a special council and special regime, to which have been appointed the chief rabbi, Rabbi Yonah Metzger, the chief rabbi of Israel, as overseers of this whole United Nations Institute of Religions. So that's where all this is motivated, and that's where all this comes from.
Yes, and what I didn't know, which had been subsequently alerted to, is that the Pope went from Jerusalem to this place, where this little settlement is, where they are building this replica and doing all these things. So why would he call in there? We don't know. He just went there. You could say he went just to have a look and see what was going on. But he went there on his way to see the King of King of Jordan.
Well, you see, if I were to tell you that, the Pope has very good Jewish friends, because one of the other overseers of this institute is a Rabbi David Rosen, R-O-S-E-N, who the Pope has made a papal knight of the Order of St. Gregory.
Yeah.
You see? So they're all in this thing together, and they know exactly what they're doing, and they are doing it very fast, as you say.
Yeah. And so what I think we are facing now, this is just me now, my own conviction, is that this polemic, this religious polemic, has been set up and has existed since way back in the 2nd century.
Yeah.
Between Christendom, because the first setting up of this polemic, we see how Christendom did it, was all about Rome regathering itself because it was being pulled apart, and it really establishes, it embraces the messianic thing, messianic message, which was growing in the Roman Empire, and eventually articulates it under Constantine at the Council of Nicaea, and Christendom, Roman Christendom, is actually established with its creeds and laws. But the first sign of it being coming into being was in around about already 160 to 180 AD, where we have an account in the book of Eusebius, which is called the Quaterdecimum Disputes. And we see that this dispute is between Polycrates and Bishop Victor in Rome. And Polycrates, and the debate is actually the date of the Passover. So at this point in time, Western Christendom as it is, as it's emerging, which is not a uniform movement by any means, but it is starting to, it doesn't say not keeping the Passover, but what it's saying is we want to change the date.
Yeah.
And Polycrates writes these letters, which are recorded in Eusebius, and the whole of the Eastern congregations objected to this, and Polycrates said, no, we cannot change the date of the festival, because I was discipled by
Polycarp,
and he was discipled by John, and we have to keep the feast, just the same as Paul says, I have to keep the feast in Jerusalem, go up. So these things were in debate. The result of that, to cut it short, to save you just going through all the books of Eusebius and the debate here, is that ultimately this debate argument went on for about 20 or 30 years. It was not a short debate. But in the end, the Roman Church and another bishop that I think was later ultimately just excommunicated the whole of the Eastern congregations.
Yeah.
So this is an important note, because what you're actually seeing is the galvanization of the North Pole, if you want to say it. The Christendom is now, and what it's done is excommunicating those people who are standing for biblical script.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
There's the beginning of the one polemic. The other polemic, which is on Judaism, now we see that rabbinicalism began in 100 years to 60 years BCE before Yeshua came. He said when Yeshua came, and they persecuted him, and they were threatened by him because he and the Essenes, the Zadoks, they had pushed out of the temple, and that polemic is now being developed during the time of Yeshua. When Yeshua says not one stone will be left on this temple, it's going to be judged, because it was no longer a temple of righteousness or under the control of authorized priesthood. It was actually under the control of rabbinicalism. He said not one stone will be left lying on this. So in 70 AD, we see the temple completely destroyed and the people of Judea exiled into the Roman Empire. We see that within the next, while this is happening with Bishop Victor and Polycrates and so on, the building up of the one pole called Christendom, we then see on the other side the building up of rabbinicalism through the development of the Babylonian Talmud in the next 200 years until they've codified their laws, just like Rome now has codified their laws at Nicaea in 325, so up to 300, between the gap of 70 and 300, they eventually get this codification of what they call the Babylonian Talmud. And that captures exiled Judah now, and their religious worldview throughout the whole. And then we see Hillel 2 and the revision of the calendar and the putting it all together so it all matches the Roman calendar and fits together and everything. And now we have the polemic from the Council of Nicaea in 325 and the Babylonian Talmud. We now have a polemic, which I'm talking about, this religious polemic, religious worldview, that on the one side is dominated by Western Christendom, and on the other side you have Rabbinical Judaism, and there we have our North and South Poles, which now explains, and this whole battle is over Israelology at its core. Okay, so now I hope you're getting to understand what we're talking about here, because if you understand this, I believe you can see that the way of Yeshua and those who follow him, the way and the truth and life, is not part of this polemic at all.
None whatsoever.
It's completely outside of it.
Yep.
And so, whilst we have had this great call to repentance, to study the Hebraic roots of the faith, it's been moved in terms of its Israelology and how Israel is to be restored. Mm-hmm. It's been captivated by particular world views and their approach to prophecy. Just like Arnold Fuchtenbaum has an approach to prophecy and how this will be resolved. How do we resolve the difference between the church and Israel, spiritual Israel and physical Israel? So the Hebraic Roots movement is trying to do that as well. Now taking on the 12 tribes as an identity and then trying to relate that to rabbinicalism, which has a view of Israel. Their definition of Israel is those who keep the oral law. Mm-hmm. Judah, Jewish people who keep the oral law. So when they go looking, when rabbinicalism, I've looked at what they keep coming up with the articles, oh, we've discovered another lost tribe. When they come back, you read the articles and you say, well, they found Manasseh, for example, in India, because they looked and they saw they were keeping elements of the oral Jewish law. Mm-hmm. You see, so it's a worldview definition of the Israelology. Christendom does exactly the same thing.
But can we prove that what you are saying is biblically correct? You know, that these two polemics, are absolutely outside the true Israel of Yahweh. Right? Do we have a biblical definition for them? Yes, we have. Because the biblical definition, and we spoke about this last week, is that if you take, for example, Deuteronomy 13, if any system takes you away from Yahweh, right, it's of the devil.
Hmm.
Yahweh says you got to take it out, and you got to remove the evil from Israel. So, this rabbinical Judaism, are they bringing the people to Yahweh? That's the question. And Rome, on the other hand, are they bringing the people to Yahweh, or are they taking them away? Well, it's clear what is happening. They are taking them away from Yahweh. Yeah. Therefore, we know it's apostate, and therefore it does not fit into the Israel of Yahweh.
Yeah, because Rome does away with the mediatorship of Yeshua.
Correct.
By saying Mary is the mediator. Mm-hmm. And the rabbinics do away with the mediatorship of Yeshua, saying they, the rabbis, the elder rabbis, Sanhedrin, are the mediator of the kingdom. So, you know, and keeping the oral law is the way that they define it. So these are the things that we're dealing with. So if we, hopefully you've got the context now of our discussion and why this is so important and why we need to study Israelology, because the scripture exhorts us to study that we may be approved, right? And we to understand Israelology or who Israel is, what Israel is, we've got to go back from Genesis right the way and the right the way through to Revelation. But I just want to come back to Arnold Fuchtenbaum, who rejects replacement theology, which is the belief that the church has replaced the Israel of the Old Testament, and says that only dispensationalism, with its clear distinction between Israel and the church, can in fact provide a systematized biblical doctrine of Israel. So, you know, what he's doing is raising up a wall of partition, if you want to, but on the other hand, he's talking about Israel as he defines as Judah, the Jewish people.
Correct.
Right, and church as the non-Jewish people.
No.
Correct?
No. Well, he says it. He says it in his introduction to his Israelology, and there he defines briefly who Israel is, and he says it are the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, or the Jewish people.
Yeah. Which goes against what happens in the Exodus story.
Oh, yes.
Because there's mixed multitude there.
Yes.
So there's a problem straight away.
Yeah.
Okay.
And what about the other tribes of Israel?
Yeah.
Is it only Judah?
Yeah.
What about Joseph and Benjamin and Reuben? And where do they fit into his Israelology? Or does he say the whole of the 12 tribes is Judah? That also cannot be. You know, yeah. So the whole thing is already confused in a few words.
Yeah, and so Arnold Furtenbaum, as an evangelical, conservative evangelical, is still within the continuum of this religious polemic we're talking about between Rome on the one side and rabbinicalism on the other side. And that's, I'm hoping, by the end of today's discussion, we'll clearly see that the way of Yeshua is completely outside of this.
Absolutely.
That the way of the kingdom of heaven is not part of this religious polemic.
No.
And this religious polemic is leading people by naivety and their lack of understanding, because they sit beneath the pulpit or they sit beneath the synagogue, the Sanhedrin, or to follow away. And then the tragedy is that the Hebraic roots movement is still carrying on within this religious polemic,
right?
And it's coming to nothing ultimately, because it's actually the opposite of Yahweh's preaching of who Israel is and what the kingdom of heaven is.
Yeah,
you see. So, you know, there's an argument even with Fruchtenbaum, because those who support Fruchtenbaum support a dispensationalist approach to prophecy.
Yes.
And then they interpret prophecy a certain way.
Yeah.
Okay. And then those who reject Fruchtenbaum don't accept dispensationalism. So they are
more a what is called a covenant theology.
Yeah.
You know, and they of course have an amillennial view. Whereas dispensationalists have a millennial view, which is that there will be a physical kingdom here on earth. But if you are a Calvinist covenant if you have a Calvinist covenant theological background, then you are an amillennialist who says no, there is no kingdom, because the kingdom is actually in heaven.
Yeah, so there's no seventh millennium Messianic reign.
No. So you can see in both is total confusion.
Yeah. So it's important that we get our Israelology right.
Absolutely.
So that we can understand Yeshua's words, Moses' prophetic words, the words of the prophets, all talking about the restoration in the last day and what it actually means, and we'll come to this in the end, what it actually means that all Israel will be saved.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the important thing. So, this is a very, very important subject, and I hope that we'll stimulate you enough to be able to study this more for yourself. It's not giving a complete, exhausted discussion here, but certainly lots to think about. So the question is, if we're looking at Israelology and trying to make it as simple as we can, and it's really complex, and I'm not saying that in an arrogant way, I'm saying I'm trying to make it as simple as that I can. It's like, how can I simply understand this for myself?
Well, let's be fair, Paul in Romans 11 calls it a mystery.
Yeah.
You know, so it is mysterious.
It's complex, very complex. Yeah. And I'm just quoting from an article here which I think is quite useful, because it says Israelology at its center is the study of the house of Israel, or the house of Jacob, really.
Yeah.
And we see this in various forms, like under David it was the house of Judah and the house of Israel. We see that very clearly. We see this in the prophets Hosea and then Malachi and all these. There's the splitting and the judgment, the different exiles and so on. So it has to do with how Israel began. You've got to look at how Israel began. It all began with Jacob. What happened to it historically, very important. Mm-hmm. What it means to us prophetically today.
Mm-hmm.
That's Israelology, right? How it began, what happened to it, and what it means to us today in the last days, because this is very, very important. Otherwise you get caught up in the wrong Israelology. And for my part, I'm seeing this polemic between Christendom and rabbinical is so strong and so pervasive, people are either warped to the Christian polemic or they warped to the rabbinical polemic, and the Israelology is buckled. Okay, it's not biblical. So the important thing here is that the house was commissioned with two destinies. This is biblical Israel. And that was that you've got to look at the birthright that was given to Jacob, right? And Jacob was given this dominion mandate that he would have rulership over the house. That's over the people of Yahweh and over the nations ultimately. And the fruitfulness mandate. So there's authority of the house, the true house of Israel, and there's fruitfulness, which is the development of kingdom, the expansion of its peoples, that people would be grafted in, and your seed will become, as the covenant to Abraham was, as stars of the heavens and sand on the seashore, grains on the sand seashore. And these are the mandates which were given to the patriarchs, specifically to Jacob who actually gets his name changed to Israel for a set reason. What was the reason? So that defines who an Israelite is by name.
Well, you see, we have the account where Jacob is wrestling with the messenger of Yahweh, which of course is Yeshua. And then he says, you know, I'm going to change your name from Jacob to Israel. Meaning, he who struggles with El and will prevail. That's why you always hear Paul saying, until you prevail till the end. Prevail till the end. Israel must prevail to the end, to its ultimate destiny. What it's chosen for to do. This is to be a banner to the nations and hold up, you know, the righteousness of Yahweh.
Mm. Okay, so Israelology is not just a simple Bible study. It's not just another, you know, let's do another Bible study reading a chapter in the scripture. It contains a lot of information when you study that is just not taught in this religious polemic, but it's taught in ways that match their worldview and not going through systematically. And I mean, Arnold Fruchtenbaum is one guy who has tried, and he's, as you say, he's regarded as an authority, who's tried to resolve this issue, but from his worldview being evangelical conservative Christian, which sees a definition of Israel as being equal to Judah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so, and that's not correct.
Yeah.
So his assumptions that he starts with are incorrect.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But so is his conclusion. I mean.
Well, it has to be. The conclusion has to be incorrect if your assumptions start with are incorrect.
If I take the word of Yahweh, and it says in Psalm 119 that Yahweh's law is righteous and stands forever. But Arnold Fruchtenbaum says that the law of Yahweh, or the laws of Moses, are rendered inoperative. Now, who do I believe? Do I believe Yahweh or Arnold Fruchtenbaum? Well, the choice for me is very simple.
Mm.
But that's how we can see how the whole thing has been confused, you know? And ultimately, you know, Yahweh has been pushed away, and man has put up his own doctrines
and theologies,
theologies which are now confusing all of Yahweh's people, and that's why he says, you know, my people perish
for lack of knowledge.
For the lack of knowledge.
Yeah. So let me carry on a little bit and just have a few definitions here of who or what is Israel. That's really what we're saying from the scriptures. Because it's the scriptures that tell us, it's Yahweh himself, our Heavenly Father, who defines who Israel is. Nobody can define it. This I find is interesting. We've got to really watch ourselves, how we define things because of our religion, our own puffed up, presumptuous religion, which is what this polemic does. You know, the polemical struggle between Christianity, the one pole, and the other pole. And as I said to you, remember, the Hebraic Roots movement is, in my definition, an overreaction to polemical error. So they battled with the error in Christendom, right? And they found out that there's no replacement theology and so on. This has all come from Hebraic Roots study of the faith, which is a good thing because that teaches us what we have to repent from. But then moving over to the polemical error that Yeshua is not going to restore the kingdom because they've listened to the rabbinical eschatology that you must work with us to make your own redemption, work it out, and you must come into agreement with us and work for the land and return to the state of Israel. And they're all looking about that. That's why they're talking about, oh, well, you must listen to the Sanhedrin in the future and you must look to the temple and it's going to be a good thing. Because this is bowing your head to rabbinical thought. Hello, what's happened? You're no longer bowing your head to Yeshua.
So we've gone from error to error.
That's right. So the Hebraic Roots movement is an overreaction to polemical error. That's my definition on this poll thing. So I hope people can understand that. And once you see that, I hope it enables you and gives you the tools just to discern where the kingdom of heaven would be, because it's outside of that altogether. So firstly, we see that Israel is defined as the man Jacob in Genesis. And that's Genesis 32:28. Then we see that in Genesis 48:28, Exodus 1:7, it is defined as Jacob's physical descendants.
Mm-hmm.
Now, immediately, you'll find that Christendom, whether it be Protestant or Roman, will come in and say, Jacob's physical descendants are the Jewish people.
That's what they say.
There's the jump. Immediately,
yeah.
But there's only one son.
Jacob had 12 sons.
Yes. So then another point is that all the Old Testament believers, and of course this is the important point, which gathered at the Exodus, were considered Israel under that covenant.
Yes.
And here's the contradiction with the definition of all Jacob's descendants, because there was a mixed multitude
yes,
there.
Very big.
From all the nations
yes.
were there.
Yep.
So how can Israel now suddenly go from the mixed multitude and all the nations and everybody represented with the 12 tribes to becoming a definition of the Jewish people?
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Yeah.
Then we find in Joshua 11:16 and a number of other references I have here, Matthew 2:20 for example is another example, these other examples, that the land, the covenant land itself is called the land of Israel.
Yep.
So Israelology becomes important in the sense that it's about a people and it's about a land.
Yep.
Right. Hence you know why there's going to be big struggles over this land.
Mm-hmm.
Then it's defined in Isaiah 7:1 and 9:12 as the northern kingdom. It's the northern house, Israel. And it comes from Jacob blessing Ephraim and putting his name Israel upon the head of Ephraim. So these are the northern tribes. So that's been a lot of discussion in the Break Roots movement.
This is Genesis 48.
Genesis 48. Then I think the definition by Christendom, I don't know if we can clarify this one, talks about defining Israel as the spiritual remnant amongst the Jewish people, but that's not exactly correct, because Romans 19:11 talks about Judah being, you know, the natural branches being grafted into Israel again, regenerated in.
Yes.
So how they end up?
They are grafted into the tree.
Into the tree.
You see, now who is the tree? You see, now Christendom will say that they are the tree.
Yeah.
Because we must be grafted into the church, because Augustine says there's only salvation in the church. You see, so you have to. But who is actually the tree? On whom should we be grafted?
Yeah.
On Yeshua. He's the tree.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Judah must be grafted on Yeshua, and Ephraim must be grafted on Yeshua, and any Gentile who is outside these houses of Israel, right? If they want to partake, yeah, with the root, they must be grafted on this tree.
Yeah. Which goes to my final point, that it is Messiah himself.
Amen.
Who actually is Israel.
Yeah.
Because he is the preeminent seed of Abraham.
Yeah.
So he is the king of Israel. He is Israel. And this is exactly what you're saying, that the tree is Yeshua Messiah.
Yeah.
So now we come to the true messianic definition. Not what Arnold Fruchtenbaum is saying, because he's wrong.
Yeah. But the Christians say we must be grafted in.
To the church,
to the Jewish tree, to the Jews grafted into the Israel, right?
Yeah.
But they don't realize that they must be grafted on the tree, which is Yeshua.
Yeah.
And that Israel must also be grafted on the tree. And admittedly,
well, let's get
this
definition.
Well, yeah.
Get the definition right.
Yeah.
You see, because he's talking about, you could say, a Jew, non-Jew.
Yeah.
Or he's talking about exiles and non-exiles. Or he's talking about, so how do we get this all resolved? What is this thing? Yeshua is the tree, right?
Yeah.
Yeshua is Israel, essentially. He's the first man redeemed Israel. You know, brought forward by Yahweh. This is the new Israel, right?
Yeah.
This is the spiritual Israel.
Natural branches.
Yes.
Yeah. In what for me is the 12 tribes of Israel.
Yes.
Natural branches.
Yes, not just Judah. That's the point I'm trying
That's
to
the
get
point.
To. Yeah.
Not just Judah.
So
the 12 tribes.
12 tribes of Israel.
Of Israel,
yes.
Right? And we have non-natural branches.
Yes.
Let them call that.
Of the nations.
Of the nations, yeah.
Yes.
Right, okay. Some of these natural branches were broken off, says Paul.
Some of them, but not all of them.
Not all of them.
Yeah.
Of the three,
yeah.
Right? So that these branches out of the nations will be grafted onto the tree.
Yeah.
Right? So they're grafted onto the tree. Not, what I'm trying to say is they're not grafted onto the Jewish branches.
No. Yeah?
That's a separate issue altogether.
Yeah.
Here we have the tree, Yeshua, and everything must be grafted on him.
You just said something now which I think describes the Break Roots movement. They see this grafting onto the Jewish branches.
Exactly, yeah.
That's the problem.
That's exactly. You hear people say that, you know.
See, they say that.
He must be grafted on Israel. No. He must, and by them, Israel, they mean the Jewish people, right? We must.
Which they see as rabbinicalism, which is the polemic, the religious polemic that dominates the paradigm.
Now, forget all that.
Yeah.
The tree is Yeshua, right?
Yeah.
And it is rooted into the covenants with the patriarchs.
Yes.
That's where the roots are, right?
Mm.
Paul says. And then we have the tree stump, and all branches, may they be natural, Is it all branches out of the 12 tribes?
All 12 tribes.
All 12 tribes must be grafted on that tree, and everybody out of the nations must be grafted on that tree. And as they are grafted on the tree, do they take of the sap of the roots, which is the covenants made with the patriarchs?
Yeah. And that, when Paul says that some of them were cut off, because you see, not all of them were, because they followed Yeshua in his day.
Absolutely.
And they were not all Judea. They were not all, some of them were not. And they, you know, they were not just the Jewish people coming to the faith. There were others. Why did he go to Galilee? You see, why did he go to I think of the Samaritan woman who's at the well. And she says, my father Jacob's will. How can you say that my father Jacob's will? You see? So we don't know a lot of this stuff because we weren't there. It's just history. But I just, you know, that's a very important point, that all 12 tribes in Paul's reference are part of the natural branches that of which many of them were cut off.
Yeah.
Because they were, because they went into all sorts of apostasy,
yeah.
Have been grafted into Yeshua.
Yeah.
He's called them out.
Yeah.
He put them in there.
Yeah.
And then of the nations, as the gospel's gone out looking for the whole lost sheep of the house of Israel, it's also the nations who've been brought in and accepted the good news gospel of the kingdom have been grafted in. And that is defined definitively as redeemed Israel.
Yeah, absolutely right.
So, you know, this is another point. While studying the lost tribes of two houses of Israel, it's been very important to understanding history and exiles and all these things that are coming to pass in terms of prophecy being fulfilled. Effectively, Yeshua had established a one house tree in his ministry from the time of his coming, not two houses.
If people are interested in this whole exile business of the two houses of Israel, if they go to the identity lectures on the inthatday.net website, I go into all this in very, very detail.
Yeah.
And what you're saying is right, and if you now see that that tree is Yeshua, which is rooted, you know, in the promises made with the patriarchs, then you understand what Paul is saying, that it is right. If you are a Messiah, then you are Abraham's seed.
You're right.
Yeah?
Now we're getting our Israelology right.
Absolutely.
Because Yeshua is the primary seed of Abraham, and Abraham is the father of the nation.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's his descendants and so on. That is the covenant that was made with him.
Yeah.
All right, we're on to track now. So I hope you're getting the picture of this, that our Israelology is defined in Yeshua, Messiah, alone. Right?
Yeah.
That's the
and
basis.
And there is no two identity theology of us, natural Israel on the one side, Aaron Fruchtenbaum, right? And the Gentile church on the other.
No.
There is no such thing. That's in the polemic.
That's in the religious polemic.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
But in Yeshua there is only one new man.
Yes.
Yeah. Based and rooted into the promises made to the patriarchs.
Yes.
So, if you are in Yeshua, you are Abraham's seed, and therefore you are an heir to all the promises.
All the promises. Because if Messiah has the supreme right to the name of Israel, Yeshua has the supreme right.
Yeah.
Then all who are in him also have those rights in him.
Yeah.
Right? Since we are joint heirs with him. That's what Paul teaches in Romans 8:17. So, what Yeshua gains in the redemption and the resurrection, that the blessings given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles, to the non-house of Israel as well. Because, here's my favorite verse, Isaiah 49. Let's read it here. 49:6, and it says, Isaiah 49:6, and he said, it is a light thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob.
Yeah.
This is to restore them.
12 right? tribes, sir.
Yes, not just
no.
Judah.
No.
Right? The tribes of Jacob.
Yeah.
And to restore the preserved of Israel, which is the remnant who have been holding on to their faith.
Mm-hmm.
And I can think of them even in Yeshua's day.
Mm-hmm.
I will also give you for a light to the Gentiles, that you may be my salvation to the ends of the earth. Thus says Yahweh, the Redeemer of Israel, and his Holy One, to him whom man despises, to him whom the nations abhor, to a servant of rulers, kings shall see and arise, princes shall also worship, because of Yahweh that is faithful, and the Holy One of Israel, he shall choose you.
Yeah.
So it's not us and our theologies that can make up our own Israelology and choose our own position, like we see in this polemic between historical Christendom and historical rabbinicalism. It is Yeshua alone.
Yeah.
That's the definition.
And I want to make a point about proving, therefore, that our eschatology is all wrong in the Christian church, for example, because they have taught for many, many years that the coming of Yeshua is imminent. It can happen at any time. But what you just read is that Moshiach, or the Messiah, Yeshua, must first regather all the 12 tribes of Israel. So therefore his coming is not imminent. We know that these houses are being regathered. This is happening, right?
They must be gathered into him, though. Not just a physical gathering of these people.
Gathered into him. And then, of course, that whole house will be reunited into one.
Yeah.
Where they will have their millennial kingdom with David and so on. And the Ezekiel temple. Not the rabbinical temple, but the Ezekiel temple, right?
Yeah.
But Christendom is always taught, it's imminent, it can come at any time, you know? But that's not so. And so with many things it's confused because our whole view of Israel is confused. That's why also, you know, the whole prophecy becomes confused.
Completely. And so you don't discern that there's coming one who's going to profess himself, but he's not going to be the Messiah of Israel. But he will appear to be because people have had their theology so buckled and they're part of this polemic debate.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter whether you're conservative, Catholic, Christian Zionist, evangelical, or Hebraic Roots Movement, rabbinical. It's all going to be caught into this ecumenical religion that they are busy going to unveil in the next few years, which is a United Nations, part of the United Nations plan.
Yeah, Resolution 181.
Yeah. What do they call it?
They call it the United Nations of Religions. And they set up a special regime. Heading A of the Resolution 181 is heading A is a special regime under which they put those who are going to rule this thing. Yeah. Of which the Pope, of course, is one, and the chief rabbi is another.
Is the other. Isn't that interesting? Yeah, a lady wrote to me and made me think some time about it. And there's something to it, just as a probably a metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
Not in personality, individual personality, but as a metaphor of what this... She's also picking... I'm looking at this polemic where historical Christendom, she sees this, that's a picture of me, or for me, of the false prophet. And rabbinicalism is a picture of the lawless one, which...
Makes a lot of sense.
Makes a lot of sense. Yeah. Another, here's your polemic at another level, you see.
Yeah.
So anyway, let's continue. So we get to this issue of the promise of the land, because if you get your Israelology right, and I've spoken to Messianic Jewish people, for example, and when I talk about the fact that, you know, Isaiah 49:6, that Yeshua is going to gather all the 12 tribes into him, and he's going to gather the Gentiles from the nations, and then he's going to bring them back to a covenant land, which is going to be the boundaries of Abraham, which is, he says, I'm going to do this in Ezekiel 20. They say to me, because they're thinking, Israel is Jewish people. Israel is equal to Jewish people. Israel equals equal to the state of Israel, which is a United Nations creation.
Absolutely.
All right? Mm-hmm. And then they say to me, but you are you going to deny a land to the Jewish people? It's sort of make you feel guilty in the sense that you're being against the Jewish people or anti-Semitic in any way. But that's not the case at all.
No way. No way.
The definition of Israel is wrong, and the definition of the covenant land is wrong.
Yeah.
Do you see?
Mm-hmm.
So this is from Messianic Jewish people. So this is where, you see, they're all caught up with this polemic mm-hmm. and the worldview of how they define who Israel is, mm-hmm. what the state of Israel is not the covenant land of Israel.
No.
Cannot be.
No,
I mean, you just have to look at it.
Yeah.
So these are the things, this is why this is very important to understand this polemic and to come out of the deception.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that once you see this polemic, you know, you begin to see a little bit clearly this call by, you know, the prophet Yeshua in the last days through Revelation, come out of her, my people, lest you participate in her sins and the plagues that are going to come upon her, because they're going to be putting this United Nations world religion with all their heads and that. And I've seen the plans of that temple. I've been watching them. It's going to have a big court. The court area, which is the great, going to be the elders of the world, as it were, with 70 of them sitting there on this semicircular, and the nations, figuratively all their diplomats sitting there. The glass panels around for the media to broadcast And these are going to be the religious laws that are going to be broadcast to the world. This is the religious, going to be the religious high court of the world. And this is how the rabbis are arguing. This is how the law will go forth from Zion.
From their Zion.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So this is all very interesting. Yeah. You see, what is your Israelology?
Yeah.
And if you're just an ordinary Christian going by the typical Christian view of Israel, you're going to become terribly confused about how prophecy is unfolding in the coming days. It's going to be confusing for many people because they do not understand this religious polemic that has superimposed themselves over the biblical definitions of Israel,
yeah,
and caused the confusion.
Yeah.
Both claiming, yeah, and both at variance, and both, yeah, in. So we
both,
can
both then taking away the people from Yahweh.
Yes. I think I reminded of Yeshua's words that when he returns, will he find faith on the earth? And then in Revelation, it says also that if he returns and there is no faith, then he's going to destroy the earth. Remember that, mm-hmm, quote? I can't give you chapter and verse right now. It's just come to me right now. But because of the prophets, such as Ezekiel and so on, we know that actually Yeshua's mandate, he will come through on this. This Isaiah 49, he will accomplish this task. So he's going to find faith in the earth. There's also Ezekiel that he's going to work to pull his people into the wilderness while all this goes on, and then he begins to judge it and set it all right and establish this so that the people can return.
Yes, he's going to bring them back into the bonds of the covenant.
Back into the bond of the covenant.
You know why?
That's Ezekiel 20 verse, let's go to 34. I'll look it up here quickly.
Yeah. Because if you are not back into the bonds of the covenant,
yes,
then Yahweh says in Jeremiah 35 verse 18, the men who have violated my covenant and have not fulfilled the terms of the covenant that they made before me, I, that is Yahweh, will treat them like the calf they cut in two and then walked between the pieces.
Mm.
So that's quite severe. So I think we should really listen to that very, very carefully.
Mm.
And update ourselves with the covenants so that when Yeshua comes and he brings us back in the bond, that we know exactly what we need to do. Because if we reject the covenant, then that's what we will end up with.
Yeah, I'll just read you Ezekiel 20, verse 37. The whole issue of meeting with him face to face in the wilderness is dealt with in Ezekiel 20 verse 33 to 44. Alright, let's read from 34. And I will bring you out from the people and gather you out of the countries wherein you are scattered with a mighty hand and a stretched out arm and with fury poured out. So this is all part of Israelology restored. In the last days he's actually going to bring Israel into the wilderness, not part of this polemic.
No.
Out of this polemic of Christendom and rabbinicalism altogether, I'm going to bring you into the wilderness because I'm going to deal with you face to face. He's going to be in the presence of his people. And I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there will I plead with you face to face. So that's a meeting. That's like when they were gathered at Mount Sinai.
Yeah.
Like as I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so I will plead with you, says Yahweh Elohim, and I will cause you to pass under the rod. The shepherd's rod is one of which side you are you sheep or you goat, or you a rebel, or are you not? You see? And I will bring you into the bond of the covenant. So the ones that pass under the rod, he brings them into the covenant. The ones that he does not pass under the rod, they are not going into the covenant. So this defines how all Israel will be saved.
Yeah.
The definition of all Israel. Because in the end, even though there's some natural born, they're not, according to Paul, there's going to be some never grafted in. But unless they're grafted in Yeshua, and they're not in rebellion, and they pass under there, everything that is left, once the rebels are out, everything that will be left will be redeemed Israel.
Yeah.
Right? Which is
outside the polemic and in the wilderness of the nations.
Yeah. Completely outside the polemic of this. Because they're setting up, when you think about it, they're setting up a temple now. under the auspices of the United Nations and with their sanctions. This has all been planned to the detail, both its legal and political jurisprudence. It's actually been done. It's now being built, this template is being built in the wilderness already with the high priest's clothing and everything, and the plan of the court of the 70 elders, which will be governing the world. And they will set up the law, supposedly, by implication, extending the rod as to what is permissible and what is not. What is, I mean, and I even see recently the Pope talking about defining who the church is. And I find that very interesting at the right at the moment, because again, he's reinforcing, he's made definitions that all these people who are Christian groups who are independent and don't take the Mass are not part of the church. Yet atheists can take the Mass and be part of the church. Yeah. There's amazing things going on here, and these people are claiming to be the Israel of Yahweh. The Israel of, you know, it's not. It's a complete deception. It has to be, because it's not biblical at all. Not biblical at all. So, the promises of the land are a sticky issue, as you say, with Messianic Judah, and they turn it into, some of these Messianics, is that you're anti-Semitic if you deny the Jewish people being their own identity and having the state of Israel, which shouldn't be called Israel at all. It should be called Judea. In fact, when they actually set it up, it was going to be the state of Judea, and they changed its name. So where Christianity in this polemic ends up, like Arnold Fruchtenbaum, for example, which leads to, is a view that the modern state of Israel is often seen as a part of the providential redemption of the Jewish people towards the fulfillment of Romans 11. Mm-hmm. Well, the question is it? You know, the state of Israel, is it? Because if you can only come through Yeshua, and the state of Israel actually outlaws the name of Yeshua under the power of the rabbis, right?
Well, why don't we take a biblical definition?
Yeah.
You know? Which is very clearly written in Psalm 87. Psalm 87. But it says in verse 5, indeed, of Zion it will be said, this one and that one were born in her. And the Most High himself will establish her. Yahweh will write in the register of the people, this one was born in Zion. So this is a Zion that Yahweh is going to establish.
Mm.
Yeah, that's why it says in the prophets, you know, the one spoke to the other and says, show me the way to Zion. We all know where the state of Israel is.
Yeah.
But show me the way to Zion that Yahweh is creating.
Mm.
And he has a register of the people that will be born into that Zion.
And it's not going to be done by, you know, 70 court of elders of and high rabbinics and the high chief rabbinate. And these ones that, well, I don't know whether that one will do it, but whether he will be the one who dons the high priest's clothing that officiates in this coming temple.
According to the information I received, is that this chief rabbi is going to wear these high priestly garments. According to what I heard yesterday.
Well, what we discussed last week in terms of biblical authority, there's no biblical authority whatsoever.
Like we saw from Nehemiah that these fellows wanted to be priests, and he says, well, where's your documentation? Where can you prove that you are of the Zadokites or
well, they'd have to be of the Zadokites of that if they're going to take up an Aaron, if they were going to take up that role. They'd have to be able to prove direct.
Yeah, we know from Ezekiel 40-48 that the Ezekiel temple, yeah, only the Zadokites are allowed
to
officiate on the table of Yahweh.
Yeah.
And not some apostate rabbinical self-appointed priesthood.
This is the deception of the polemic.
Yeah.
The religious polemic. Because on the other side you've got the Pope declaring that he is the high priest.
Absolutely.
You see?
Yeah.
So it's the same problem. It's Nicolaitanism, which Yahweh says in Revelation he hates, isn't it? So, I think the issue is it's not that we are denying the Jewish people a home state that some Messianic Jews would criticize, like they criticize me. Oh, you're doing this? It's anti-Semitic. If you have a view that, you know, you grafted in and Israel is, you know, your Israelology is so inclusive in this way, instead of Israel being Judah, and the state, so the whole thing becomes, we're at variance in terms of understanding how the prophecies are going to unfold.
We want Judah to take his place
yeah.
in the Israel of Yahweh. yeah. as our brother, right?
Yeah.
Because we want to sit at the feet of Yeshua and worship the Father, right? Together, right? That's the land he should be looking for.
And I submit to you that the whole, all the conflict-riddenness of the Hebraic Roots movement and the Messianic movement in general is because of this confused Israelology. Completely confused.
Absolutely.
And it's confused right the way through. Yep. Christian Zionism right the way through. People yep. are just doing their own thing.
It is Ruth you know? All over again who says to the girls, you go back to Moab, mm-hmm. right? To your fathers and to your things. Well, we know there is no salvation in Moab, right? So they're actually sending them to their death.
Mm. Yeah. So I think that from that discussion we can see what we discussed is that the way of Yeshua, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, the kingdom of heaven that he was proclaiming, which would be advanced by this, by the witness to the gospel of the kingdom, is something that has always stood outside of this polemic of Christendom and rabbinicalism. And that Christendom and rabbinicalism is the primary example of taking of how religion, religious men, have taken, tried to take hold of the kingdom by violence. There is blood on their hands because they are trying to take back what was given in this mandate to Jacob, which was the mandate of the dominion and the fruitfulness. Those two things. Now, who would actually be trying to get the that's the birthright blessing. Who's trying to get the birthright blessing back according to the template of the book of Genesis? It's Esau, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because he pleaded with Jacob, trying to get it back, trying to get it. He regretted everything he's trying to take it. So we have this incredible battle, which we understand is a last days prophetic battle between Esau and Jacob. So I submit to you that if you're looking at rabbinicalism and Christendom, this is my understanding, it is a religious polemic of the house of Esau.
Esau, yep.
And actually, the redeemed ones, has there's always been a remnant, and some of them have been in this polemic because they don't understand, and they've been lack of knowledge. You know, I know a lot of believers, I was also in Christendom, very sincere believers, do not understand this because they're persuaded by the Fruchtenbaums, etc., etc., having for themselves sat down and said, look, I've got to unravel this thing of Romans 9, 10, and 11. Romans 9, 10, 11 is never taught in conservative or evangelical pulpits, ever. And then they don't go back and try and resolve this with Ezekiel 33, 34, 36, 37 and all this thing about, you know, and the two houses being exiled. So all this, which when we began to hear this great call to repent, to follow the authentic Yeshua by studying the Hebraic roots of the faith or the heritage, or going back, in other words, the biblical word would be going back to the ancient paths or the old ways to understand like the covenants and everything that why we are where we are now. If you haven't done this work, right, then you're not going to understand this. You're going to sit listening to the pulpit. And the pulpits are now giving up their way to Rome.
Yep.
And the Rome is going to make ecumenical faith, right, together with rabbinicalism for an ecumenical world religion,
yep.
where it will begin to proclaim laws as to who's part of the kingdom and who's not.
Yeah, and then we mustn't forget, you know, that within the leadership of institutionalized Christendom, it's not only that there is only one God, the God of Israel, because as far as they are concerned, Allah and the God in Israel are one and the same.
Mm.
Now that's total apostasy.
Yeah, because Yahweh, you know, they say, you know, because Yeshua is the son of Yahweh.
No, that's Proverbs chapter 30, you know, that Yahweh has a son.
Mm.
So the scriptures testify that Yahweh has a son. But the Quran testifies that Allah has no son. So therefore they can never be one and the same.
Mm.
So therefore we know that the leadership of Christianity is apostate. Yeah. That alone should be enough for people to say, righto, I'm going to wash my hands of all this and get out of here.
And the same for the other side of the polemic. I mean, why are these people talking so much to the rabbis? Why are they giving them so much attention? Why does everybody go along to the... That's where the Hebraic Roots movement has gone. They're doing exactly... They've rejected the one era for another era.
Yeah.
What have they done? They've neglected and turned away from Yeshua Messiah. That can only be. It's the authority of Yeshua. They don't understand biblical authority.
And the scriptures warn us about this quite severely, you know? I mean, if you take... And I'll quote you from the book of Galatians, And it's not only in the New Testament, so that everybody understands our terminology, but it confirms the passage that we dealt with last week, which was Deuteronomy chapter 13, whereby if you take people away from Yahweh, you should be accursed. And Paul deals with this in Galatians chapter 1, and he says in verse 6, I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Messiah and are turning to a different gospel. So what we need to do is, we need to determine the gospel of Yeshua, right? The doctrines of Yeshua, over against the doctrines of these
two sides of the polemic.
Mm. Yeah? And then we will be able to see who stands accursed. Because Paul says, this is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Messiah. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one which we preach to you, let him be eternally accursed. As we have already said, so now I say again, if anybody is preaching you another gospel other than what you have accepted from us, let him be eternally accursed.
Yeah.
So that's the issue. Because any other gospel takes you away from Yeshua, and that's the consequence. So therefore, we've got to take note of what gospel we are listening to.
Well, it's been it's very interesting, because the implication is, we've touched on this, is coming up now in the very next year or so, when they start to actually pull this ecumenicalism, global ecumenicalism, off, and it starts to take shape. You're going to have to know what biblical Israelology actually is, and you're going to have to know the covenants, and you're going to have to know Yeshua, and you're going to have to hold on to that.
Yeah, and the true gospel.
Yeah, and realize that Yeshua's gospel and his way is completely out of, he's not even along this continuum. You can't be like within the Christian conservative, reformed, you know, Christian Zionist, there's all different degrees of somewhere along this polemic. You're either in Yeshua, grafted in to biblical Israel, or you're not, according to the biblical truth.
So we agree without hesitation that the tree on which we have to be grafted is outside the polemic.
Yeah. Outside the polemic of historical Christendom and historical rabbinical.
Right. So therefore, we must repent.
Yes.
And we must get to the tree as quickly as we can. Yeah.
Repent to be, yeah.
Which confirms the book of Revelations, which says, you must come out of Babylon.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a scripture I use, it's really comfort to me in Isaiah. It says, come my people, go into your house and close the door, because I'm rising up now to judge the wicked. Because there's coming a time when he's going to judge all this that's set up. It's setting itself up for judgment. And yeah. If he did what to Sodom and Gomorrah, what he did, he's going to do something to this. And I think when Yeshua warned, he says, when you see these things that Daniel said, then you better flee from Judea, specifically mentioning Judea. So that's going to be a place of Yahweh's wrath, I believe, what this is going on. And when it says, come, my people, go into your house and close the door, I don't believe we're going there just to sit and twiddle our thumbs. But the issue is, you're now dealing with the issues of the house. We keep on exhorting one another, encouraging each other in the scriptures. You see what I'm saying? But we're not talking to the polemic. We're not talking to the debate there. There's been a debate for the last 20 years, 25 years, with Christendom, because that's where the calling has been, come out of Christendom into the study of the Hebraic roots of the faith. But the tragedy has been the overreaction of the Hebraic roots movement and how it's been infiltrated by rabbinicalism and allowed the rabbinical anti-missionaries to have a field day there.
Yeah.
The issue is that we've had this, Christendom has been spoken to, people are going to come out, because I don't think that the sincere evangelical Christian, when he sees these things starting to unfold, that on the United Nations, he's going to see that this whole thing called Christendom, which is going to be firmly boundaried by Romanism, and together in ecumenicalism with rabbinicalism, that they will have locked all the doors and that he doesn't fit.
And?
Right? And that's when he... And so that means that we who are listening to this message need to be equipped to actually be able to share the biblical message of true biblical Israelology and the gospel of the kingdom.
But what it also confirms, if what you're saying is right, that they are apostate, and that they have no authority and they have no legitimacy, then how can that be raptured to a heavenly state?
Well, it won't be. No, but it's not even going to happen. I mean, that
well, okay, you and I know that, but lots of people who might be listening to this
looking for it.
Are still looking for it.
Yeah. No, he's going to take us aside, and we're going to be discipled, and there's going to be a great pouring of the Spirit, and he's going to be in our presence.
So therefore, that's on the Christian side. On the Hebraic Roots movement side, let nobody be charmed by leaders who say, come, you've got to come to
authority,
the state of Israel.
Which is illegitimate.
We're going to go see the rabbis, and we go, huh?
That's exactly what they're doing. They're trying to make their own eschatology, take the fulfillment of what they understand as the restoration of the 12 tribes of Israel into their own hands.
So you've got to lock yourself in your room in the nations, and wait for Moshiach to come.
Yeah.
Yeah. To bring you back into the bond of the
kingdom. Stay there, confident. Doesn't mean to say you're not witnessing about the gospel of the kingdom.
Of course,
you're not encouraging one another in the faith, because many are still going to come. You know, this is going to be this is the time of the great harvest. The question is that the laborers are few, he says. But the issue of the laborer being few is because nobody understands Israelology. They haven't got the tools to do the harvesting with. You see.
Yeah.
So I just think we'll close, if I can close with these words, these are comforting words from Isaiah 51. And I'll just read them. In fact, you know, I encourage you to read Isaiah 52 as well. But this part here, hearken to me, you that follow after righteousness, you that seek Yahweh, look unto the rock from which you were drawn. And to the hole of the pit from whence you have been dug out. Remember, we've come out. What is the pit? What is the pit? It's this polemic of religion.
Yeah.
Right? Look to Abraham your father.
Huh?
Israelology, right?
Yeah.
And unto Sarah that bore you. For I called him alone and blessed him and increased him. For Yahweh shall comfort Zion. That's biblical Zion. Mm-hmm. And he will comfort all her waste places, and he will make her wilderness like the Garden of Eden, and her desert like the garden of Yahweh. Joy and gladness shall be found therein, thanksgiving and the voice of melody. Hearken unto me, my people, and give ear unto me, O my nation. For a law shall proceed from me, and I will make my judgment rest for a light of the people. My righteousness is near, my salvation is gone forth, and my arm shall judge the people. The island shall wait upon me, and on my arm they shall trust. Lift up your eyes to the heavens, look upon the earth beneath, for the heavens shall wax away like smoke, and the earth shall wax old like a garment, and they that dwell therein shall die in like manner. But my salvation shall be forever, and my righteousness shall not be abolished. So, you know, just encourage you to read Isaiah 51. There's a lot more there. It's all about waking up. Wake up, wake up, wake up. Lift up your weary hands and, you know, don't worry about it in terms of what's happening in the polemic of religion. This is what we are called to this time. We are called to this age. We are called to see the glory of the King and the redemption of biblical Israel.
Yeah.
The question is, are we grafted in?
Yes.
Isn't it? And if you're not grafted in and have any doubt, then you need to accept Yeshua as your Savior, confess your sins, follow Him, and be obedient to His words by living by your faith in Him. And so Isaiah 52 goes on and says, awake, awake, put on your strength, O Zion, put on your beautiful garments, O Jerusalem. So, you know, there's coming a time when the unclean are going to be purged away, and the clean is going to be set up. And it's going to be trying times. But if we know our identity, and we know our Yahweh, who we are, and we know His word, that's what it says, then we will be great servants for Him in the coming days. We will do great exploits.
Yep.
Right. So blessings to you all, and that's where we'll leave it for today. Amen.